So first of all, I was telling John, I don't know if you know, we went to school together. So we have a long history, and it's really come full circle for me to be here at a gallery and him bringing his students to come see me. So I'm very grateful for the opportunity to talk to you guys. I appreciate you coming here and looking at my work. So why I'm excited is because I want you guys to look at me and relate to me. An underlying theme of what I want to leave you guys with is anything that you think in your heart right now that you want to do, you can. And the only thing that it takes to get there and follow your dream is you believe and a confidence in your own work. Don't listen to every time they tell you no, because I turned every no into a yes. And it's a beautiful thing. So that's kind of like my background and where I'm at. And after we do a little Q&A, we'll see what that conversation leads to, and there's a few other things I'd like to leave you with at the end. So I'm going to take questions, I guess, from whoever's
ready. Yeah, sure. Yeah. And if you do, everybody do.
Absolutely. It's actually more common than you would think, you know. And I think for a lot of people, in a grander scale, that's what makes people lose their dreams. And stop painting, or stop writing, or stop making music, because those blocks can be incredible at some time to get through. And I was just talking to the one teacher about it. It's a fight. It really is. You know, even in this show, knowing that I had 2 years to paint it, and there's a deadline and a certain level of quality that I expect in my own work. When you're sitting there and you don't know what to paint, and the ideas aren't coming, and you see a blank canvas, and you don't know what to do, and you're frustrated, you know, throw a brush here. The only thing I ever come back to is I was an athlete. I played sports a lot. And in the same way, in athletics and training, you might have a bad game, you might have a bad practice. But if you string together 40 practices over the season, you're going to be a better player the next year, you know? And so sometimes when I'm painting in the studio, I'm painting and it's ugly, man. And it doesn't look good. And I'm not happy. And my friends come in and don't talk to me. That's the block. And I always look at it as an opportunity to learn. Because if you paint through the block, if you paint through the creative void that you don't have anything that is worthwhile or you feel like you can connect to the painting, if you get through that and you come out on the other end, it's kind of like, again, to athletics, it's like, you know, achieving something, winning a game, or beating a team you didn't think you could beat. You come out on the other end and you're equipped with a different self-confidence, a different belief in your own talent and your work. So my advice to you would be, when you feel like you have that block and you don't know what to do, just start with the line. Just start with a brush stroke, and then connect that to something else, and splash paint, and do it, and just keep making marks. It's like a finding of yourself in a blind tunnel, and that eventually gives you light, and you know where to go from there. Yeah. So that's a new talent, and the DNA tricks and things like that. So as these cutting-edge technological and scientific discoveries were being made, he applied that to his art. And it was such a teaching tool when I sat there and really studied before what it was about. And then when I saw it after the thing, you know, and this is all before I'm just looking at the painting. And then when, you know, the original of this, and I saw the Tour de Tour, and, you know, I would look at the original of the Les Angeles and understand what he did with the towers. I was blown away. It was like, I sat there and I said, okay, I know I want to make art for the rest of my life, but this is the kind of art I want to make. It's relevant to society. It's relevant to the day. It's technically sound. He creates an entire movement and genre from his own brush. And those things stuck with me forever. So when I started making my own art, I would hide things, use double elements. It was always about a symbology and a meaning. You know, if you come to see my work with a backpack or maybe you came into the gallery, when you come and you look at my stuff, I want you to leave with a full book bag. But not with books, not with paper, but with thoughts and concepts and lessons. So you leave with a different perspective on whatever situation it was before you got here. And in doing so, as I developed my own work over the years, people would say to me, yeah, you know who Dali is? Yeah, I know who Dali is. Well, your work really looks like it. You know, you remind us a lot of Dali. I said, I can see how you say that. I'm influenced by him. He's one of my favorite painters. And then I started gaining exposure and doing more shows around the city, and my name started getting out there. And it became kind of like a thing. He's the new school Dali. He's like, you know, an urban, you know, modern age, Dali's the realest painter. And to be honest with you, it's a huge compliment. You know, and at first I was just like, come on, man, I can't paint like Dali, you're crazy. And then it started becoming like, wait a second, do you guys realize that I'm making my own original work? Well, are you just saying that my work is not my own and it just looks like his? And so that was really the derivative for this show, was sitting there and saying, okay, you've all compared me to me. You see the similarity, you see the influences in my work. Let me take that concept a step further. You know, let me really imagine if this man was born in the same year that I was and influenced by the same culture and generation that we are, what might his work look like? And that's where you're standing in front of, is my vision of what he would have painted these same concepts nowadays, influenced by the same things that I am. So to me, it's ever since the first day that I thought about making art, he was there. And as I stand today, at one of the best points and apexes in my career, he's still there. So to me, he's like a godfather. You know, he's like a man. And another reason why I did this, because I think that, you know, a lot of people don't know about it, to be honest with you. So it was a double education. You're going to learn about me as an artist, but you're also going to learn about who, in my opinion, is one of the best ever group. So it's kind of an homage, you know, a huge respect to the man that I look up to, but also in a way to say, I want to make this relevant for you guys. You know, you can come in and see Dali's work, but are you really going to relate to the countryside of Spain and to the cliffs and stuff? Maybe we all have like a country home that goes through. I like the woods too, I like nature, but it didn't relate to me. You know, what relates to me is bricks, subways, graffiti, street, concrete. You know, in schools, like, I see all the scholarship thinking students walking down the hallway and I'm going to sit up in front of a computer. It killed me, you know, because in here I knew what I wanted to do. And I came to New York to do this. But it was kind of like a sacrifice you have to make to really come back around the corner and follow your dream. So I remember sitting there and I was studying the kids in the department, I'm looking at the artwork. And I said, you know, I really want to make something that doesn't exist, you know? And I remember I got an 18 by 24 on this Bristol pad. And Bristol is a very thick paper, okay? And it was the biggest piece of paper I've ever seen in my life. But it's only 18 by 24 inches, you know what I mean? It's only this big. But at the time, it was huge. And I remember, I was like, where do you start? What do you do in the beginning, you know? And this comes back to the question, I had the block. Literally, I went one stupid big mark right across the paper. And I left it there and I looked at it and I said, man, I need a new piece of paper. You know, what did I need a new one. It stinks. And I kind of sat there and I was like, well, wait a second. This could build down this way. You know, and I made a profile and I did this. And that was really the starting point of my style and figuring out what kind of art I wanted to make. And it was literally the first piece that I ever sat down and made my own composition. I still have the drawing. It's actually part of the tattoo I have on my arm because it was such a monumental piece for me. It was the first time that I said, I'm not going to look at anything for reference. There are no pictures here. It's coming straight from my head onto this piece of paper. Let me see what I got, you know? So it was really when I think I got out of my comfort zone. You know, I wasn't the excelling student in a two-year high school art class. Now I was an unknown, not even able to be in the art department. Everybody had studios and easels. I had Photoshop, you know? And so to look at that and to understand the position that I was in, I really wanted to be like you downstairs painting. So I really just took a risk, took a chance. Let me see what I got. I pulled a piece of paper out. Started making that first mark, and 2 or 3 hours later, it looks like something that's really cool has started to happen, you know? And it goes back again to the answer. I painted through the block, or I drew through the block, and then you get to the other side. And I was like, wait a second, this is pretty damn cool. I've never even seen this before. Where did this come from? And that kind of led to another style, and then the pencils went from pencils to paintbrushes. You know, so colored pencils, the same way I would do a color pencil or lay down a color theory, I would do it in acrylic paint. So it was really a process over many years, but it really started happening when I left home. Finally confronted with the first time, like, this is your dream, man. What are you gonna do? You're gonna work in computers for the rest of your life and make everybody else's website look good and design their logo and make their art show flyer look really good? Or are you gonna make your own dream happen? And that's when I sat down and I said, let me do it. And what the ironic part is, and we were just kind of, you know, reminiscing about it, I was the first student at Hofstra University to ever have an art show in the university gallery. And I wasn't even a scholarship painting student. And it started from literally not taking no for an answer. You know, no, we don't show students in the art school gallery. Why? There's a month open. I had the show ready, I had my flyers ready. And I used the disadvantage to my advantage. You know, one of the biggest things for me is because I learned graphic design and a business and the idea how to brand yourself, I had everything that all the artists downstairs didn't have. So if I wanted to have a show, I could print posters out and make flowers. I had all my friends literally walking around, here, take this, you need to come to the show. Listen, you need to come to the show. Yeah, and we flooded the campus just like that. And so everybody knew from that point on, that's the artist, that's BK the artist. And I'm not even an art school kid, but everybody knew it, you know, it was. So it's kind of like you make your own path, you carve out your own journey. And I don't even know if it's all together yet, to be honest with you, brother. You know, it's still a work in progress, but that's the most important part. As soon as you're satisfied, that's when you start regressing. You know, I don't know where my art is going to go. I don't know what the next concept is, but I know I'm never going to stop. You know, so I've long said to people, I'm going to be two things. Either the hardest working artist that never made it in some obscure apartment loft with thousands of paintings, like hoarded up in my house. They're coming in, you know, but this is falling away, you know, just move this, you know? Or I was going to be successful and really make my dream happen. And I'm okay and committed to either outcome. But the truth is, if you really work hard and you believe hard enough, you don't be the obscure guy. People take notice. And thank God, and I'm very grateful that I've been noticed and it's starting to really happen for me. So it started from a whim and taking a risk, and it's developed into something that I really believe in.
Outline your stuff before you paint it?
Never. I never sketched before I painted. It's kind of an interesting concept. And I started doing that because, to me, if I would have sketched this out and give this whole outline of this piece, I know the follow of this. I'm so uninterested in painting the rest of it because it's already done. I'm just filling the color, you know? It's like the process has lost all of its fun for me because it's like a blueprint and I'm just following the equation like a math problem. And here's my solution. The beauty to me as an artist, I get so happy when I'm in the studio and it's a big white canvas and I'm literally like a kid. I'm like, oh my God, I can't wait. I don't even know what's going to happen. You know? And I do something, I step back, and I'm like, oh, that was cool. And I come back, and I'm like, oh, I was horrible, I should have done that one, you know? And that's the process. And there's no thought, there's no preconceived notion of what it could be. There's elements that I know. But one of my favorite quotes, and forgive me for not knowing who the originator of it is, but they said every painting that's on a wall is dead. It's dead. A painting is alive when you're making it, you know? In it, it's like the process of the thoughts and the execution out of your hand. You know, I always look at it like my hand, my mind, my brush to the paint, to the touch of the fiber on the cotton canvas is one. It's one huge gateway for creativity. And as soon as it comes off and that brush dries and the canvas is good and you seal it, it's kind of like dead. It really is. It can still live and it's beautiful, you can look at it. But the alive part is in the process. And that's why I never sketched, that's why I had to plan it out. Because to me, I don't want to do it feeling dead, you know? I want to do it feeling alive. And I think that is another thing that has allowed me to really develop my own unique style and continue pushing, because I can draw very well. And I could probably sketch out concepts and do these amazing things if I really pre-plan. But to me, real art is made out of no plan. You know, it's made out of really just that moment, that spark of creativity when you're sitting there and anything in the world is a possibility. And that's where it becomes spiritual in a lot of ways. Because you sit there and you don't know what the end result is going to be, but you just believe that whatever is going to come through you and filter through you to make this work is what it was supposed to be. I had joked with the teacher before, we have 50 unfinished works in my studio. I have more unfinished works than I do finished. And it's because that frustration, that block, not knowing what to do next, or quite literally sometimes I'll get a quarter through a painting and I will just stop. Because I know I already know what it's going to look like. There's no other ways I have to go and I'm very unhappy. It died on me. We didn't even get to live our life together. So it just goes into that, you know? But yeah, one of the interesting things about me, no, I never sketch. It's always right there, right on the spot. And that's what really makes it real. You know, sometimes it's not pretty. It's not pretty at all. You know? It's really ugly sometimes. You know, but that's what makes you a better person, right? You're a young man. There's probably parts of your life that you say, yeah, I could have been a better dude here and there, right? But you work on yourself, and in the end, you become a really good man at the end of it. So in the process of painting, that's kind of what it's a young man. It's still figuring itself out. It's learning life lessons. But you keep on painting, and you get to the end of no sketch, right? You know what your future's going to be?
No.
Did anybody in here sketch your life out? Right? So why would I sketch art? It's the same concept. You're a work in progress. So am I, so is every other painter. So that's the concept that you look at, you know?
A lot of your works, I see like hidden faces everywhere. What do they like represent? You know?
There's a few different reasons for the faces appearing that way. First and foremost, it started with, you know, I've always just been fascinated with human interaction. Everything you did today, even coming to the city, when you take a second and think about it, is pretty amazing. The subway system, the skyscrapers, the architecture, the streets. You know, it's hollow underneath and there's trains going. You know, think about it. How do we deal with all this on top of each other when all this crazy stuff is going on? And so it really started with the fascination of everybody around me and the people who make up this world, who make up history, whatever it may be. And I think that too often we forget, you know, what our fellow man is going through, what a stranger on the street might be dealing with in their day. And they're hidden to you. In the same way that they're hidden in the painting, it's hidden to you. But when you see it, you can't help but go back to that piece and now see that profile every time. So that's a metaphor for life, you know. Notice the down and out bum on the street, you know. And maybe he's asking for $5, but offer him a meal sometime, you know. Pay the guy behind you's toll at the Verrazano Bridge, even though it's $13. For what? Just to do it, you know. And then that concept has developed over time. A lot of it now, I do these faces with bodies and faces inside the face. And what that was about is, I quite literally am the sum of everybody that's ever been in my life, good or bad. You literally are a walking sum of your relationships. If you've had a good upbringing, good parents, you carry it with you. If you've had a bad upbringing, bad parents, you still carry it with you. If a girl's hurt you before, she's on your back. If a girl's loved you the right way before, she's still on your back. So when I do these faces of you know, 17, 18 bodies inside of a face, what that is about is when you meet somebody, you don't know what their experience has been. You don't know what those relationships have affected them. But it's a reminder that your responsibility, the only thing that you can control, is that if they carry you with them and you make an impression on their life, so you're part of the 18 bodies that make this face, that you're a good, positive, you know, experience for them. That you're a good member, that you're the one that, if I'm still hanging on your back in 10 years, you think about me and it's a positive thought. And a lot of it has to deal with the idea that, and it goes off this painting, you know, social media was so connected, the idea of technology and Instagram and Facebook and all these different programs, right? And social media is socially connected. But how often is it really just breaking us apart and making us So with me hiding the faces and the profiles and the elements, it's a constant reminder to everybody else around you who doesn't have the same blessing, you know, to be aware of everybody and what's going on, and to be always focused on, no matter who I meet, young or old, doesn't matter demographic, where you come from. I want to make sure that your experience with me, to the best of my ability, is a positive one, so that whatever you leave after meeting me with my art, or even if it's at a coffee shop and it's just for me to open a door for a lady, you know. I'm aware of how I look. I got tattoos. You might be at first, but she's, you know, an old lady and she doesn't really, she gets shocked by that imagery,
right?
But if I say, hello, how was your day? And I open the door for her. Do you need help carrying the bags to your car? It doesn't matter who else she sees for the next 5 years, she's not going to have that first stereotype that she did. Just the way you carry yourself, the way you speak, you know. And so to me, it's all relative to life and how you live it. It's all relative to how you treat people. And I know, how old are you? 17, right? So I'm 30. So you got 15 more years of people affecting you, good or bad. How are you going to wear them? How are you carrying them? You know, are you going to let them weigh you down? you're going to stand up and do what I'm up with. And that's the concept behind it.
When you were painting, that this is too hard for me to do, right? That you really just can't do this. Have you ever said that to yourself? Because I know I'm dealing with perspective and stuff, and I'm having a really hard time at one point, and I'm just like, I got to put it down because I don't know what I'm doing.
Absolutely. More often than you would think, you know. And specifically, even with this show, there was at least, honest to you, maybe over 25 times where I was just like, I got to call Kevin. I think I bit off more than I could chew. You know, like, maybe it wasn't like a good idea to try to take on one of the greatest painters that ever lived and just do it justice, you know? Absolutely, man. And there's still things to this day that I wish I could do that I know I can't do. What the important part is realizing your own faults, you know, understanding the flaws in your own work and your technical skill. As soon as you can self-diagnose what needs to get better, you can give yourself the medicine, right? So if you know you need perspective work, for sure, take a step out of the art world to understand perspective. You can look at it in a book all you want, but stand in front of a skyscraper and look straight up like this and see how the angles converge. When you go outside, look down the city block, you know? Always think in angles. Think about a box, right? So when I do letters, which are incredibly hard to paint at an angle and make look realistic, you know? You start off with the shape of the letters. Don't think of the word. Start with the rectangle. If the word is art, artwork, bigger word. So the word's like this, right? Just think of how you curve the top. You know, you have to, the trick to me as pretty much a self-taught artist has been looking at it from a different angle, you know? They talk about when you draw things, look at the negative space. Everybody focuses on the subject at hand or what you're drawing. Look at the white spaces in between in relation. If you were drawing me, what does this area inside my elbow look like? Everybody focuses on the arm. Look at this. This is just as important. And so when you do perspective, it's not hard, man. And you should be having problems with it. You know, it's not hard. I mean, it is hard. You should be having problems with it. But just keep working at it, you know, and think of it outside of the way that you're stuck, you know. Think of it as like a problem. What other way can I attack this intellectually, you know, that can make me understand it better? And don't be afraid to have the human element in it, you know. Perspective is just perception. It doesn't exist, really. It's just the way that our eyes perceive the world from a distance, right? So if you have your own human touch, the way that you perceive that, the way that you portray that, own it. You ain't gonna apologize to anybody. If you're technically trying to get it right, learn it, technically. But if you always have a tinge of a different way of doing that, that's your style. That's your style, the same way this is my style, you know? And then what you do is spend the rest of your life making everybody believe that your style is dope. Who else?
Come on. What do your tattoos mean? Because I'm really interested in tattoos, and I like the way they look.
They're pretty cool, man. I actually shaved my arm and drew this with a big pen. Okay, and Kevin, as a tattoo guy, is probably like, you're crazy. But as an artist, I didn't really trust anybody at that point to put what I wanted on it. So the first three is called the Omelet. It's an ancient Druid symbol. They built Stonehenge in England. Okay, it's huge. Monolith blocks. You guys familiar with Stonehenge? You've seen it, the circle, okay? So you can see how the shape is set, right? And what it stands for is a spiritual illumination from the sun. So the left side is for the female, the right side is for the male, and the middle is a harmony of opposites. The eye is the Egyptian eye of Horus, so it's what the wisdom of what this symbol teaches. Then the eye, the nose, and the mouth, and the part of the hair make the female. So the left side, right? And then you flip it upside down. And there's the man's face for the other side of the sun. I don't know how far away. Xaverian High School is my favorite painter. And quite literally, if you look at that,
oh yeah,
it's something. Okay. 505 is where I met my friends in college. That's our dorm room. When I first got to New York, it was the Twin Towers. So that's the city, the Twin Towers. This is an Egyptian Am, which means life. This is an African Athenian symbol, child of the heavens. And these are all faces and profiles, like you see in my pieces all the time. This is an andogram here, which means namaste, which means the divinity in me, recognize the divinity in you. On my right side, this is grief for grandma. She was an artist in my family, but she passed away. I told her that she would bless everything that came out of my right hand. So she's here, she's branded on it, whatever I think, I see my grandma. These are the four elements, earth, air, fire, and water, also an andogram. So it reads the other way, earth, air, fire, water. This is my hometown, Baltimore, where I come from. So literally when I paint, I remember everybody that I do it for, everybody that I left, why I'm here in New York. This is Arabic for patience, because one of my biggest problems is patience. So quite literally, it's like my textbook. Be patient, Brian. You love your home. Hi, Grandma. I come from the earth. You know, this is wisdom right here. So it's literally me teaching myself and reminding myself different elements of who I am and aspects of it. And, you know, your body is a work of art itself. So to me, my tattoos all have a very deep meaning for myself. So if you are getting ink, don't do some stupid stuff.
Yeah, fellas, I left the tattoo commission slips at home.
Yeah.